Thank you so much, choir and orchestra, and I invite you to open your Bibles once again with me to the book of Ezra, the Old Testament book of Ezra, as we continue our study through this book. And as we are opening our Bibles to Ezra chapter number 4, I want to tell you, I really am encouraged by what I sense in my spirit that God is doing in our days of rebuilding around here. Because I think that God is challenging us to something far more important than simply rebuilding the material things with which we have been associated, that we have lost. But I really think that God is challenging us to rebuild our spiritual lives. Last Sunday morning, we looked at Ezra chapter number 3, and we saw how that God's people, the children of Israel, had gone back to their homeland under the leadership of Ezra. They had rebuilt the broken down altar, which was their place of worship. They had laid again the foundation of the temple that had been destroyed. And we talked about that being a picture of the foundation of our Christian lives. And we talked about those essential ingredients of that foundation as being repentance and confession and prayer, the Word of God, obedience and faith, and rebuilding those areas. And I was encouraged last Sunday morning, as so many people, when they came by, they said, "Pastor, I want you to know that God has really spoken to my heart, and I have begun to repair some of the cracks in the foundation of my Christian life. I've just taken some things for granted, and I've let them slide, and I really am getting serious about rebuilding those areas of my life that the enemy has come along, I've allowed him to, and he has actually destroyed, and I've lost my effectiveness as a follower of Jesus Christ." And what I want to try to do in the sermon today out of Ezra chapter 4 is I want to try to show us that when we make that commitment to rebuild our spiritual lives, it will not be easy. In fact, we're going to face great opposition. There's going to be a fight and a struggle on our hands when we make that determination. And yet, if you and I have enough courage and faith to continue to fight that battle, the end result will be an amazing thing, and God will transform our lives, and He will use us for His glory. So today, I want to talk to us on the subject of something worth fighting for. And what is worth fighting for is the rebuilding of our spiritual lives. Now, I want you to look in Ezra chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. And I want today to just read through the first five verses of this chapter. The Bible says, "Now, when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel and the heads of the fathers' houses, and they said to them, 'Let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do. And we have sacrificed to him since the days of Esarhaddon, the king of Assyria, who brought us here.' But Zerubbabel and Jeshua and the rest of the heads of the fathers, the houses of Israel, they said to them, 'You may do nothing with us to build a house for our God. But we alone will build to the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us.' Now the people, then the people of the land, they tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in building. And they hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, the king of Persia." Now, get the picture in mind what's going on here. They had rebuilt the altar, the place of worship. They had laid again the foundation to the temple, which had been destroyed. And after they had done that, they began the work on rebuilding the temple. And just as soon as they began that work, the Bible tells us that war broke out. Now, I've read just verses 1 through 5 this morning, and I've done that because actually verse 6 down through verse 23 of this chapter is a parenthesis. And it's a parenthesis that includes a later event within the nation of Israel. And that particular event actually involved the days of Nehemiah, when Nehemiah had gone back to the city of Jerusalem for the purpose of rebuilding the city walls and the city itself. Ezra was concerned with rebuilding the temple. Nehemiah was concerned with rebuilding the walls. And I think that Ezra purposefully inserted that little parenthetical statement made up of verses 6 through 23 because he was trying to stress something. And what he was trying to get across to his audience, and I believe trying to get across to us as the audience today, is that any time that we attempt to rebuild for the glory of God, there will always be opposition. And what Ezra was pointing out was that just as there was opposition in the rebuilding of the walls, and just as there was opposition when they rebuilt the temple, the opposition was there, but something else was there as well, and that was the living God. And he was trying to get them to understand that God is always faithful in helping us to do what he wants to do in the rebuilding of our lives. Because you see, friend, as you and I have made that commitment, and we have that desire, we want to rebuild our spiritual lives for the glory of God. If we're going to rebuild, something else is essential other than just our effort, and that is God's faithfulness. And over again, that is stressed in Scripture, especially when God has called his people to perform a particular task. For example, you will remember that Moses wrote in Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse number 9, when a new generation of Israelites began to occupy the promised land, he gave them a verse of Scripture to encourage them that God would be with them. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. Listen to this verse. Therefore, know that the Lord your God, he is God, the faithful God. You see, Moses knew that not only did the older generation, but the newer generation, they needed to hear the truth about the faithfulness of God. And friends, you and I need to hear that today as well. The older generation and the newer generation as well. Yes, we have to do our part, but God is faithful always in doing his part. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24, he who calls you is faithful, and he will also do it. And so if God has put a conviction on your heart, you know, there's some areas of my foundation I need to shore up. My prayer life, my commitment to the Word of God, my repentance, my confession of sin, my living by faith rather than sight, my walking by obedience. Listen, if God's put on your heart that you need to make some course corrections in those areas of your life, God is faithful to bring that to pass in your life. And you ought to live by faith knowing that you're going to see the victory in that area of your life. And so as we think about this whole idea of God's faithfulness, God helping us to rebuild, there are about three things I want to say out of this text today. Number one is I want to talk a little bit about expecting opposition. We ought to expect opposition. We ought not to be surprised by the opposition. Chapter 3 of Ezra, verse number 13, closes with God's people praising him. It said, so that the people could not discern the noise of the shout of joy from the noise of the weeping of the people, for the people shouted with a loud shout, and the sound was heard afar off. And then we open in verse 1 with the opposition. I wonder if it was not because the people who were not the people of God, they really don't like it when God's people begin to praise him. And there is always opposition as the result of that. Nothing makes Satan more angry than for God's people to praise him. When we start praising him and rejoicing in his goodness and his grace and his mercy, the enemy does not like that. Those that were living in the land when the Israelis got back there to rebuild the temple, in verse number 1, they are referred to as adversaries. The adversaries. Maybe in your translation, the word enemy might be used, but the word adversary literally means enemies, and so these people here, they were the enemies of God and the enemies of the people of God. Now, friend, listen to this and listen carefully. Once a believer decides, I am going to rebuild my spiritual life. I am just so sick and tired of things being just normal and average. I want to go deeper. I want to rise higher. I want my commitment level to be what it's never been before. I want to experience this living God in new and fresh ways. And once a church makes a decision, we are tired of playing games around the foot of the cross. We want to mean business with God. We want to be this, not just a group of people that assemble and listen to sermons and sing songs, but we want to be a mighty army of the living God, pushing back the darkness that enacts laws like they did in New York just this last week. We want to make a difference. And friends, when we as an individual believer, or we as a corporate church, when we make up our minds and make that decision, we move from the playground to the battleground. And we can expect that there's going to be some opposition. You see, friends, anytime there is advancement, there is always adversity. Anytime there is progression, there is always persecution. Anytime there is movement, movement always creates friction. Vance Havner one time said that Satan's not worried about Christians who won't do anything. He's not worried about those that just warm the pews. He's not worried about those that, you know, really are not in it with all of their hearts. And then he closed by saying, Satan never kicks a dead horse. But anytime there's movement, there's friction. And friend, don't you forget this. Great opportunity always results in great opposition. And the greater the opportunity, the greater the opposition. So we've got to be willing to roll up our sleeves and fight for it. It is something worth fighting for. It is not if opposition will come, it is what we will do when the opposition does come. Now, friend, I don't know about you, but really that's where I struggle. Well, how do I handle the opposition? How do I handle the New York crowd that passes a law that you can kill a baby at birth? How do I deal with opposition? That's something we all struggle with. I read about a farmer who happened to be a Quaker. And you know that Quakers were those that were committed to godliness and holiness and purity. But this old farmer was a Quaker. And he had a mule. And if you know anything about mules, you know that mules are quite stubborn. But this particular mule was particularly stubborn. And one day the old Quaker was trying to plow his field, but he couldn't get it done because the mule would not move an inch. And finally, the old Quaker went in front of the mule, grabbed him by the bridle, looked that mule right in the eyes, and he said, "Thou knowest I am a Quaker. So thou knowest I cannot curse thee. Thou knowest I cannot whip thee. But what thou dost not know is that I can sell thee to my neighbor down the road. He is no Quaker, and he can beat the living daylights out of thee." Well, we can't curse the opposition. We can't sell the opposition. We can't whip the opposition. But there is something we can do with the opposition. And if we will better understand where it comes from, then we are better equipped to handle it. And so as I look into this text, I see several things about this opposition as we talk about explaining the opposition. That's pointed out so clearly here, and the same thing is true for you and for me today. Explaining the opposition, how did it come? First of all, the first temptation was for God's people to compromise. If we look down in verse 2, it says, "Then they came to Zerubbabel, the heads of the fathers' houses, and they said to them," now mark this, This is the ones that were called their adversaries. They came to them and they said, well, let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do. And we've sacrificed to him since the days of Esarhaddon, the king of Assyria, who brought us here. Let us help you out. Now, that was such a subtle temptation, because on the surface, it sounds like a good thing. Let's just all join hands and let's just all work together for the building of the temple. Surely that's a good thing. Everybody will be happy. No one will be offended. Everybody will be pleased, except maybe God. God would not have been pleased with this, because the people here that were offering to help, the Bible refers to them as Samaritans. And those that were from Samaria, they were not on the Lord's side. They claimed, you know, we worship the same God that you do, but they didn't. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that the Samaritans were a group of people that when the Assyrians would conquer a nation, they would take that nation, they would mix it with other nations, and so there was this great big amalgamation, you might say, of all kinds of religions that ended up with all kinds of gods. And they didn't worship the same God. The only reason why they wanted to participate in the building of the temple was so that they could control and influence the people of God. And you see, Ezra was wise to that, and so was Zerubbabel. He said, you're not going to have any part in our building. We're going to do this, and we're going to do this alone. Over in the book of 1 Kings, for example, chapter 17 and verse number 33, in speaking about the Samaritans, the Bible said that they feared the Lord and worshiped other gods. And you just think what would have happened if Israel would have allowed these pagans to participate in the work of God. Pretty soon they would have been socializing, they would have been intermarrying. And pretty soon, God's plan for their life as a nation would have been corrupted. And you see, that was the whole point that Ezra was getting at. You can't compromise on this issue. You can't allow them to be a part of the work. You see, God had set Israel apart. They were a separated nation. God had a specific purpose for them. And if they would have been corrupted by the pagan people around them, then God's work would have been hindered and God's purpose for their life would not have been carried out. Now, friends, I'm here to tell you today that God's requirement of separation from the world did not end with the Bible. God still commands us to live a life that is separated from the world. And we are not to compromise in any way that would harm our testimony or would hinder the work of God through us. Now, friends, listen, separation doesn't mean isolation. But the Bible says of the Lord Jesus that he was holy, he was harmless, he was undefiled, he was separated from sinners. That's what the Bible says. And yet he was also a friend of sinners because he sought to win them. But the way that Jesus won sinners was not like being sinners. The way Jesus won sinners was being different from sinners. And you see, there's always that compromise, maybe no greater than it is today in church life, to just be like the world. Do you remember what happened after the first exodus of the children of Israel? The Bible says that they moved into the land of Canaan, and Joshua says that they conquered the land. But if you know anything about Bible history, you know that something happened when they got into the land of Canaan. They began to live too close to the Canaanites. And the result was, according to the book of Judges, they became just like the Canaanites. And the result of that was they were driven out of the land because they became like the world. And now here we have these people, and they are facing the same temptation that their fathers faced in that first Exodus. So the question is, would they compromise? Would they be impacted by the lifestyles, the philosophies, the ideas, the norms and the mores of the world around them of that day? Or would they be different? Would they be holy? Would they be pure? Would they be righteous? Would that glorious light shine through them and impact the world like God raised them up to impact? And friend, can I tell you, that is precisely the calling that God has put on our lives today. You know, I've challenged us. I've challenged myself. I have challenged you. I have challenged us to rebuild every ministry of our church and to rebuild it based on Deuteronomy 11, verse 13. And that verse says that we are to love God, obey God, and serve God. And that anything ministry-wise that does not help people to love God, obey God, and serve God, then the church ought to be out of business when it comes to that kind of a ministry. Friend, the days are too short. Jesus is coming. We don't have time to waste. It is time for us to make up our minds and say, you know what? We're going to build this church, First Baptist Panama City, on biblical principles. That's what we are going to do. And friend, I want to tell you, when we do that, there's going to be opposition. There'll be opposition right here in this congregation when someone is told, well, I'm sorry, but we can't invest money in that. We can't invest any time in that. We can't do that in our place because that doesn't help people love God, obey God, and serve God. Somebody's not going to like it. There's going to be opposition. And when you make up your mind, man, I'm going to repair the cracks in my spiritual foundation, there's going to be opposition to that. But friend, what I am begging us as a church today to do is simply this: don't compromise. Let's not compromise. Let's not give one inch, because nothing good ever comes out of compromise. Would you not agree with me that sometimes the church, and we're guilty of this too, we look at an activity that's going on, a church does something, and we just kind of scratch our heads and we say, what in the world does that have to do with the proclamation of the gospel? Friends, that's what we've been called to do, right? That's it, nothing else. Let's not compromise that. Everywhere where you read in the Word of God where people compromised, they always lost. Adam compromised God's law, followed his wife into sin, and lost paradise, Genesis 3. Abraham compromised the truth, lied about Sarah's relationship to him, and nearly lost his wife, Genesis 12. Sarah compromised God's word and sent Abraham to Hagar that bore Ishmael and destroyed peace in the Middle East that lasts to our day, Genesis 16. Moses compromised God's command and lost the privilege of entering the promised land, Numbers 20. Samson compromised his devotion as a Nazarite, lost his strength, his eyesight, and his life, Judges 16. Israel compromised the commands of the Lord, lived in sin, and when fighting the Philistines, lost the Ark of God, 1 Samuel 4. Saul compromised God's divine word by not slaying the animals of the enemy, and he lost his kingdom, 1 Samuel 15. David compromised God's standard, committed adultery with Bathsheba, murdered Uriah, and lost his infant son, 2 Samuel 11. Solomon compromised his convictions, married foreign wives, and lost the United Kingdom, 1 Kings 11. Judas compromised his supposed devotion for Christ for 30 pieces of silver and was separated from Christ eternally, Matthew 26. Peter compromised his conviction about Christ, denied him, and lost his joy, Mark 14. Later on, Simon Peter compromised the truth in order to gain acceptance by the Judaizers, and he lost his liberty, Galatians chapter 2. Ananias and Sapphira compromised their word about giving, lied to the Holy Spirit, and lost their lives. Acts chapter 5, we never win by compromising. And friends, my challenge to us today is, listen, let's be the people of God. Let's be the church of God. Let's be known by our commitment to Christ, not by our compromise with the world. And so the first temptation was temptation to compromise. Second temptation in verses 4 and 5 was the temptation of intimidation. I think that the enemies were saying, you know what, if we can't beat them by getting them to compromise, we'll just intimidate them. Verse 4 tells that sad story of intimidation. Then the people of the land, they tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in building and hired counselors against them to frustrate the purpose all the days of Cyrus, the king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, the king of Persia. And so they just intimidated them. They told lies about the Jewish people. They even hired lobbyists to try to sway and influence the elected officials. And all of it was a matter of intimidation. I see here three ways in which the enemy will try to intimidate us out of our commitment to Christ. Number one is ridicule. Ridicule. That may be the hardest one to swallow right there. No one likes to be ridiculed, do they? Of course not. A lot of people stand tall when they're being shot at, but they will wilt like a flower when they're being laughed at. No one likes to be ridiculed. Can I tell you that when we are being ridiculed because of our commitment to Christ, we're standing in some pretty good company. David was ridiculed by Goliath when he came to fight him with just a little slingshot and five smooth stones. And the old giant laughed at him. But friend, when the smoke cleared, it was the shepherd boy that did it God's way that was standing. The Lord Jesus was ridiculed, there hanging on the cross, laughed at, mocked, jeered by the crowd. But friend, when the smoke cleared, he rose from the dead. And anytime we make a determination, we're going to stand for righteousness, we're going to be ridiculed. Those teenagers in our service today, that teenager who makes up their mind, you know what? I'm going to maintain my sexual purity until marriage for the glory of God. You'll be ridiculed for it. That teenager who says, you know what? I'm going to keep my mind in good condition by not influencing it with drugs and alcohol. Oh, you'll be ridiculed. But I want to remind you, any time that the world ridicules us, Jesus takes up for us. Don't let ridicule intimidate you and steal that commitment to Christ away from you. There's ridicule. And friend, I want to tell you, when you and I make up our minds that, you know what, we're going to rebuild our church, our lives, based on nothing but biblical principles, we'll be ridiculed. When you say, you know what, Deuteronomy 11:13, that sounds pretty good to me. That's what we're going to build our church on. The church will be ridiculed. The church today that makes up its mind, we are going to follow Christ and Christ alone. We'll be ridiculed by the worldly church. It's amazing how much the world has crept into the church. How we need to take an open, honest look at the very heart of who we are and what we do. So the ridicule will come. And sir, ma'am, if you decide here today, you know what? It's all in for Jesus. You're going to be ridiculed, and it may be by those closest to you. It may be by a backslider in your own family. Well, man, we're going to live for Jesus. We're going to commit it all to Christ. And yet that backslidden husband might say, look, I want you to love Jesus, but just not that much. Don't go that far. Expect the ridicule. I think there was a second temptation here that went along with that intimidation, and that was fear. Fear. The Bible says that they stopped building the temple because they feared the people. And the sad thing is, friend, it worked. It worked, because over in verse 24 of our text, it says, thus the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem, it ceased. And it was discontinued until the second year of the reign of Darius, the king of Persia. If I've done the math correctly, that's 10 years. For 10 years, God's work did not go on because fear crippled them. Let me stop and ask this question this morning. Why are so many people absolutely afraid who are followers of Christ to totally surrender to the lordship of Jesus Christ? Why are we so afraid? Well, it could be because of ridicule. We don't want to be ridiculed. Or maybe it's because of the requirements. We just know that if we do that, something in our life is going to have to change that is not pleasing to God right now. We're going to have to give something up. We're going to have to make some adjustments. We don't want to do that. But friend, I can guarantee you that if you will run to this altar this morning singing, "All to Jesus I surrender," your life will change and you'll be glad that it changed because you'll be blessed as the result of the change. Why should we fear living underneath the lordship of Jesus Christ? Why is it that so many unsaved people are afraid to give their lives to Christ? Maybe it's for those same two reasons. Maybe they don't want to be ridiculed, or maybe it's that, you know what, they're concerned about the requirements, what they're going to have to give up if they come to Christ. But friend, think about it. What you get if you come to Christ is so much greater than what you give up. What you get is His righteousness. The only thing you have to give up is your sin. That sounds to me like a pretty profitable exchange. His righteousness for your sin. Why wouldn't you want to give that up and surrender to Him? Friend, the only way for us to live today is just by totally surrendering. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. And friends, when we do that, He makes life worth living. There's fear. Then there was discouragement. The Bible said in verse number 4 that the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah. Discourage them. Discouragement is the chief occupational hazard of the child of God. It'll put us on the sidelines. Now let me tell you how we can apply this to the two areas that I'm talking about: rebuilding our church ministries based on nothing but biblical principles. Deuteronomy 11, verse 13. Rebuilding the foundations of our lives. How does this discouragement factor into that? Well, if we make a decision, you know what? Every ministry that we seek to do, we're going to do it this way. We're going to do it God's way. We're going to do it the Bible's way. There is the potential for discouragement. Why is that? Are you listening? Say amen. Amen. Because initially, when we do that, we may not see growth from that. In fact, if we take a ministry, people have tried this before and say, "All right, I'm going to do it, but just the Bible way. I'm not going to let any of the world come in and make any influence." Initially, what may happen is that some of the crowd may leave instead of staying because some of the crowd want more than God, which kind of blows my mind. How could there be anything more than God? So initially, there may be a subtraction of attenders rather than an addition of attenders. Y'all look at me like I've lost my mind. I know what I'm talking about. Sometimes God's word thins the crowd out, doesn't necessarily build it. But if we have the courage and the faith to stay with God and do it His way and His way alone, the end result will be absolutely phenomenal because God will be glorified in that and God will show up in ways that we've not seen Him in a long time. And I tell you how the discouragement works when I say, okay, I'm going to rebuild. I'm going to the foundations of my life that have cracks in them, I'm going to rebuild that. Here's how the discouragement works. You make that commitment. 2 days later, you mess up. And so all of a sudden, you're discouraged. Well, I tried it, but it didn't work. Try it again. You know what we do? When we make that commitment to the Lord, Lord, the Lordship of Christ. So that means whatever the Lord says to me. If He tells me to use my time differently than I'm using it, my money differently than I'm using it, I'm going to do that. I'm living under the Lordship of Christ. But all of a sudden I mess up. What do we do then? We get up, dust ourselves off, put that failure in the past, and move forward. Because the Christian life is a life of new beginnings over and over and over and over again. But the enemy will seek to discourage us because of our failure. So there's fear, there's discouragement. And then there's one last thing, very quickly, that is enduring opposition. What do we do with opposition? We don't escape it, we endure it. But how do we endure it? I'm going to give you two words. I want you to write these two words down, because I'll guarantee you these two words will get you through any opposition you will ever face. First word is the word focus. The word focus. What do we focus on that helps us get through opposition? Number one is we focus on what He said. What He, that's God, what God said. Every single believer needs at least five good verses containing the promises of God that are memorized. Five good verses that you can commit to memory so that when the opposition comes, you can fight the opposition the way God says to with His word. Now, just in case you don't know five, let me just suggest to you five. You ought to write these down and start memorizing them today. Isaiah 26, verse 3. God will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on Him. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your heart and mind through Jesus Christ the Lord. Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Psalm 37, verses 4 and 5. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways unto Him. Trust in Him, and He will bring it to pass. Matthew 11, verse 28. The Bible says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. How about 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58? That's six of them. Be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Every believer needs at least five promises of God that you can pull up, that you can hold on to, that you can anchor your life to when the winds of opposition begin to blow. So focus on what He said, and then secondly, focus on who He is. I think in one of King David's darkest times in his life, he gives us that example in 1 Samuel 30, verse 6, when it says, now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him. That's opposition. Because the soul of all of the people was grieved, every man for his sons and daughters, but David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Focus on Him. David said in Psalm 16, verse number 8, I have set the Lord always before me because He is at my right hand. I will not be moved. focus on who he is. So the first word's focus. Second word's friends. How do we get through opposition? Friends. Remember when Elijah was facing the opposition of Jezebel? What did God do? Did God reach down and wipe out Jezebel? No. God gave Elijah a friend. His name was Elisha. What did Jonathan do when he was, or David do when he was facing the opposition of Saul? God gave him a buddy. His name was Jonathan. Friend, everybody needs somebody that they can share their life with, their story with, their burdens with. Everybody needs somebody to whom they can be accountable, somebody that will pray for them. Pastor, I just don't have any friends. But doesn't the Bible say, he who would have friends must show himself friendly? There are plenty of people in this place that would love to be your Christian friend if you would just take the step and show yourself friendly. But as long as you just want to live out there on an island by yourself and play the hermit, you're not going to have anybody to support you and to help you. We all need friends. Focus and friends will get us through our times of opposition. In closing, let me say that opposition is a good thing. You will not find any Bible great who did not face great opposition. And God uses that opposition to form us, to shape us, to mold us into the men and women of God that he would have us to be. Opposition is good for us, and it's good for the glory of God. Where would you be today if you had never faced any opposition? Where would I be if I'd never faced any opposition? It's said that when Sir James Thornhill was painting the inside of the cupola of St. Paul's Cathedral in London, that he finished up one section of the painting and he stepped back on the scaffolding. One step further, and that scaffolding was way up in the air. He would have probably fallen to his death. A friend saw what was going on, so the friend ran over, grabbed a paintbrush, and just put a big mark through what he had just painted. And when the artist saw that, he rushed forward to protect his work. And in rushing forward to protect his work, in reality, his life was saved. Friend, when you look at the painting of your life and it's scarred by opposition, just remember, maybe that's God's way of rescuing you from something far worse or preparing you for something far better. Opposition in the hand of the master sculptor can make us into his beautiful creations. Would you stand, please? Heads are bowed and eyes closed. And Father, thank you for your amazing word that speaks to us so clearly and so specifically exactly where we live. God, I pray that each of us would be honest enough today to just simply pray the Bible and say, examine my heart, O Lord. Try my spirit. See if there is any way of disobedience in my life. God, I pray that you will continue to challenge us to rebuild our spiritual lives as we rebuild our church facilities. And in the end, you would be glorified for it. Father, I pray for that person who is here today who is not a Christian. They've been afraid to come to Christ because of all of the demands or the responsibilities that they think might be on them. I pray that they would move beyond that fear today and exercise faith in the only one who can forgive them, take their sins away, and give them a home in heaven. I pray in Jesus' name today that the hearts of your people all across this sanctuary, Lord, to be in tune with you, praying, Lord, I want to commit myself totally to the Lordship of Christ. I pray for those who need a church home, Holy Spirit, that you would move on their hearts and draw them to this place today. Lord Jesus, you are so worthy of our utter best. Thank you for the privilege of serving you. In Christ's name I pray, our heads bowed. Thank you so much for tuning in to our broadcast. I hope that you have been strengthened and encouraged in the faith through the music and the teaching of God's Word. Our goal here at First Baptist Church is to help people love God, obey God, and serve God. And this is also the goal of our television ministry, and so I pray that this has happened in your life today. I would love to see you personally and meet you if you ever have an opportunity to visit with us. And remember, you're always welcome at First Baptist Church in downtown Panama City.